At this time, we will now move to our keynote session where Dr. Nunez Smith will bring the keynote and it will be moderated by Dr. Jane Middlebrooks Morgan. Thank you.
Hello, I want to welcome everybody. I am I'm Dr. Jane Morgan, excuse me. And I welcome everybody here today. We certainly are very excited and honored to have Dr. Marcela Nunez Smith with us today, the senior advisor to the White House COVID-19 response team and the chair of the US COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. What an amazing accomplishment. We are so proud of her and we're so happy to be in your presence today. Certainly, the conference this morning has been wonderful. We've gone over a lot of the social and economic issues that we are really facing with health equity. And certainly, this has been a part of your passion and your work, Dr. Nunez Smith, really for your lifetime. And as we transition now to this part with you, we're going to transition a bit more to science and what is the science telling us. But also we have such an expert right here coming to us from the White House to give us such a wealth of information. So we welcome you.
Good morning. It's so wonderful to be here. Such a kind and generous introduction, Dr. Morgan. But I've been looking forward to this because I look around and it feels like family. And so I've been looking forward to this conversation all week. Just thank you so much for the invitation to be here.
It's our pleasure. You know, I thought we would just start because, you know, I know you probably don't know this, but so many of us don't know a lot about you. And maybe we could just start with your journey here in America and how you came to be at Yale and how you ended up on the White House Task Force and health equity and how that became your passion. Maybe you could take us through that.
Oh, thank you. I'm happy to. And I know health equity is a passion shared by so many of us here gathered at the conference right now. And, you know, for me, sort of the life journey, I always start with where I grew up. I think it's so important. I'm from St. Thomas in the U.S. Virgin Islands, a place I hope you've gotten a chance to go to. And hopefully as we reopen that you can return to, just a beautiful island in the Caribbean, one of our US territories. And that really shaped a lot of my early experiences and interactions with healthcare. As we know, it's a community where health and healthcare resources are limited. And there are issues and challenges. We have our young folks dealing with chronic disease and battling chronic disease. And having a hard time, right? Being able to get the preventive care as well as always the latest and greatest in treatment. So not ever, right? I'm a person who's very asset-based in my thinking. And so a rich community, very rich in assets and amazing clinicians and amazing providers. But at the end of the day, it's about systems and structures and policies. Some of the policies having to do with being a territory specifically, but not all, and just that reality. And that's what we have to confront and moving forward, how we have to disrupt these patterns of inequity. But, you know, I left St. Thomas at the age of 16 and came to the mainland for college. I did undergrad up at Swarthmore College. It was a small liberal arts school outside of Philadelphia, a city that I love. And I, you know, actually after undergrad, I deferred a medical school to help my mother care for her mother who had Alzheimer's dementia, and just another important part of, I think, our collective narrative, right, in terms of our families. And I owe so much to my grandmother for all that she did for me. And so it was really just a deep honor for me to be kind of part of that last year of her life there in a daily way. But I taught high school, which was a really interesting perspective. And so I was a 10th grade homeroom teacher, and that was amazing, and taught high school science. And a lot of my students are now physicians and other clinicians, and that's really inspiring. But you know, after that, I went to med school in Philadelphia at Jeff, and then we were just starting to hear the language health disparities, right? And that was coming into thing, but went to residency in Boston at Brigham and Women's Hospital, where I did internal medicine. And then I came to Yale to do a fellowship in health services research. And I always knew, you know, at this point, the field was certainly growing, and knew from my experience as a clinician that for my patients, we needed to talk about what was going on outside of the walls of the hospital. We needed to do more about connecting with community and addressing social economic needs, as I know we've been talking about this morning here. So, you know, it's been almost two decades for me at Yale, where I've been working as a researcher, primarily also a clinician, and started a research center. They're focused on health equity. But, you know, as they say, I was very much, you know, minding my business one day when I got a phone call asking if I would be willing to come and speak to the candidate about COVID-19 and health disparities. And at that point, I was chairing for our governor here in Connecticut, Governor Lamont, a committee focused on how we make sure there's equity in COVID-19. And I was happy to come and talk to the candidate. You know, first it was candidate Biden, and then it was candidates Biden and Harris on a regular interval about COVID-19. So, and then to serve as a co-chair of the COVID-19 Transition Advisory Board.
Yeah, you know, so impressive. And, it, you know, you encapsulate that beautifully, but actually that's, you know, over two or more decades of your time, including taking a year off to really care for a family member who contributed so much to your life and what that experience is like. Now you've brought that forward into what health equity really means. When we look at it now within our healthcare system, within our big medical facilities and medical establishments, we really are just starting to get our arms around. How does health equity interact with these health systems? How are we practicing medicine? Should we continue to practice it this way? You know, how does that go from stem to stern, all the way back to research, which is really your bread and butter? It's starting there. And how does that cascade out to how we actually end up delivering healthcare? And so as a part of this conversation, we're going to maybe just talk a little bit about the science, because in addition to the societal construct of where we find ourselves in this country and the vaccine rollout and all of the vaccine hesitancy, which I've spent a great part of my of this COVID pandemic addressing vaccine hesitancy, part of that hesitancy is the science. People don't really understand it. What does that mean? Messenger RNA, what's that? So I would like to just kick it off to say, can you tell us, does this impact our DNA? Is this messenger RNA the same as DNA? Do I need to be concerned with what my grandchildren might look like if I take this vaccine and 30 years later? So these are the kinds of questions we'll just start with. Well, does this impact our DNA?
No, it does not impact our DNA. And I'm so grateful, Dr. Morgan, for you to bring this up, because it, you know, it's conversations like this that we need to have. People have real questions, right? And I honor all those questions, because it's a lot happening quickly. Who among us has been in a place like this before, right? None. And so I think this is exactly what we need to do. We have to say, look, let's figure out, let's get on the table these things that are part of the you know, the decision-making process for folks, and let's tackle them. Let's always be honest. Number one, right? We got to always be transparent, lead with science, lead with data. When we have the evidence, we speak to it. When there isn't an evidence, we say, we don't know yet. What we always can say is we know what COVID-19 is doing to our families and our communities, right? So that's always the balance too, is that we know for sure what COVID can do. And it's devastating. And not just in terms of loss of life, but so much more, right? All the economic stress, we know people can live with long COVID, right? Have to deal with those symptoms. So we know we're in a race against the variants. So we have, you know, a list of concerns. Plus we know that kind of getting vaccinated is how we reclaim our joy. So reasons too. So, you know, let's tackle those questions. And one of the keys I think people need to know is that the science hasn't been that quick, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's been decades actually in the making, back before even President Obama's time, people have been working on this mRNA technology. And so it doesn't affect our DNA at all. It won't worry at all about kind of the grandkids or even for yourself, right? It doesn't stick around in our bodies. So it's new technology to a lot of us on the outside, but decades in the making.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a great explanation. When we look at the, you know, the rollout, I guess, of this vaccine and the lack really of education that came out ahead of the rollout. And people had a lot of hesitancy. There were a lot of questions. And not only were there questions with regard to the science, but there were questions with regard to the intersection of healthcare and research and the US government. And you know, these haven't always been easy relationships with our communities. And so we can understand why there was so much vaccine hesitancy and where that came from. And then we were sort of doing really well, right? The first 100 days of the Biden administration, and we ended up with a pause on our J&J vaccine. You know, in the midst of really starting to ramp up, having a lot of congratulations and starting to begin to peel back some of the layers of some of the vaccine hesitancy for people with whom we can really answer those questions. So can you talk to us a little bit about that J&J pause? What was it about? And what did we find out about it? What should we know now that it's back on the market? Should we move forward with this vaccine? And tell us what you think about that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Appreciate a chance to talk about J&J, and the pause was paused for a week, as I'm sure most people heard. And you know, for the perspective I bring to this is, you know, we always have to talk about these processes. I really like how you framed it, Dr. Morgan, in terms of the rational reaction it is for people to say, we're not really sure what's going on with government and some of these institutions. You know, President Biden himself has come out and say, like, he knows the federal government, healthcare institutions have not always treated particularly Black people and Black bodies with the respect, right, that they deserve. And so we always have to start there. And one of the reasons why I think people were skeptical is that there seemed to be so much political stuff going on at the time when the vaccines were first coming out. And it made you wonder, like, is the science that's leading it? Is the politicians who are leading it? Like, what's going on? And so, you know, the processes with the CDC and the FDA, all these different alphabet soup, right? It, like, this is transparent. And I'm here to say, I have confidence. I was also very worried, right? But I have confidence now in these processes that they are led by scientists, that they are anchored in data. People should know the scientists are diverse. The scientists who were involved in creating these vaccines in the first place, diverse. The scientists reviewing, diverse. The clinical trial participants, diverse. So really important for us to kind of just gather that data, share it with our neighbors and our communities. But specific to J&J, right? So why do I start with processes? Because with these vaccines, we have processes in place for surveillance, right? To all these questions people want to know. So are you tracking? How are you so sure that it's going safe, that everything is going as intended? I think it's remarkable. I really think it's remarkable that in 8 million doses of that J&J vaccine, that the system was sensitive enough in the surveillance system to pick up those first 6 cases of these unusual blood clots. I mean, that's amazing, right? So when you sort of say, I don't know if this is working, I'm like, that's working. 8 million and 6. So the blood clots are serious, right? And that's why there was a pause, abundance of caution. FDA and CDC said abundance of caution. We want to make sure, we want to take a stop so we can study these cases in depth. We can see if there are others, right? So anybody else out there, if you haven't reported it and you had a patient who presented with these symptoms and this kind of blood clot in the brain, let us know. And then third, to tell providers how to treat those patients, because it's a little bit different from how we typically treat patients with blood clots. So several important reasons. But the meeting that they had, I actually watched the last bit of it. It had a multi-hour meeting to discuss the sort of evidence and the data. And the decision of the group was that the J&J vaccine should be made available again, with obviously people being informed. That's my takeaway always, right? Stay informed, be informed, get your information from trusted sources. So be informed. These cases, the ones they talked about, happened in women under 50. Mm-hmm. And so the recommendation is that it's available for everybody, but certainly be informed. And now today, happy May Day, you know, in May 1st, we have enough supply in the country that if you want choice, you have choice, right? So definitely stay informed, talk to your providers, get your information from people you know. But I feel in the end of the day, the system is working, gave me great confidence as far as the surveillance with the vaccines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I am loving this conversation with you because, you know, obviously when J&J had the pause, it cast somewhat of a chill over the ramp up of the vaccination effort that we have moving forward. And Additionally, I agree with you. There was such a sensitivity to it that even though the FDA took a closer look at it, and we eventually found 15 people instead of six, and they didn't all have these, what we call CVST thromboses, but they did have blood clots, and 13 of them were between the ages of 18 and 48, and two were over the ages of 50. So, you know, Dr. Nunez-Smith is saying this is information that we should have, but we should not step away from the vaccines. These are incredibly rare occurrences with a system that's incredibly sensitive and being very transparent with people of color like Dr. Nunez-Smith directly involved in it, such that we can make certain that all of our perspectives are well represented. So I'd like to ask you, the first 100 days of this pandemic response, getting your hands right into it, where are we with equity in this pandemic in the first 100 days? And where would you like to see it go, or where are you taking it? Mm-hmm. What should we expect?
Yeah. So when we talk about COVID-19, thank you for the question. You know, we have to think about all the resources. And so I often remind and say, look, we're thinking about making sure people have access to testing as well. We're making sure folks have access to treatment and therapy. And we've done a lot there and made substantial investments there because there are therapies for COVID-19 and Black and Brown communities have not been accessing them in quite the same way. We have to make sure that happens. We have to talk about PPE, make sure everybody who's out there, especially, you know, our workers, right? Healthcare workers, other frontline workers, that they have the right PPE. So we're thinking about all of those COVID-19 resources in addition to vaccination, which I'll come back to. But then absolutely we have to think about the response, but then the recovery, what resilience looks like in our communities moving forward, how we make sure there are pathways to economic and educational opportunity. So that's kind of all on the table for work and for policy and intervention and consideration. When it comes to the vaccine specifically, you know, from day one, always, and I tell you, the president and vice president, these are not words for them. These are not talking points around equity and centering there. This is their first question, their last question, every briefing, right? They are focused. And if you heard the president speak this week, you will see the focus remains on equity. And in the first 3 weeks of the Biden-Harris administration, we said it's going to be access, right? We're going to absolutely have conversations with people like we've been having about confidence, getting information that you need, and all of that. And we're doing that. That's very important. But we know that vaccination needs to be easy. It needs to be convenient. It needs to be in places where people trust, you know, and that is number one. When you are at yes, it can be complicated to get your vaccine. And so starting off early on, we launched several direct vaccine allocation programs, meaning that the federal government is giving directly to these different sites vaccine to be able to think and center on equity. So this doesn't replace what states do and local jurisdictions do. They get the majority of the vaccine supply. But we said it's really important that we have intentionality at the beginning around access, and we continue to push on that. And so that's our community vaccination centers and sites, those located in some of the highest risk zip codes on purpose, but also thinking about targeted geographic eligibility there, making sure that, you know, there's partnerships with faith and community-based organizations to hold registration slots, and thinking through all of these issues that are the structural barriers. You know, we have partnerships with the retail pharmacy program. Now, tens and tens of thousands of pharmacies across the country, local pharmacies, independent pharmacies, as well as chain. And working with our community health centers, there are 1,400 of those directly, right? And also standing up mobile. We got to go where people are. We know that that's really what has been making a huge difference at pop-up. And just thank you, because I know that I'm looking around at a screen of people who've been out, right? Advocating, pushing, helping, doing all the work for our communities. And so thank you for that. And I honor that. And moving forward, we're doubling down on these access questions. We're also making sure that people have transportation solutions if that's part of the challenge. The president announced, you know, over $10 billion focused on equity in the vaccine response and thinking about infrastructure long-term too. Some of that is helping community health centers build back better, right? And so kind of thinking short-term and long-term in that process. So I am always wanting to hear where there are still kind of access challenges, because we know that that's so terribly important at the same time that people have access to good information like we're doing today. And we've launched our national public education campaign again, in partnership with community and trusted leaders. It's always about partnership.
Indeed it is. I was looking at data as a part of my job, just nationally with regard to monoclonal antibody infusion access. And there's a difference between who's accessing that across this nation. And even locally here in Georgia, there is a difference between who's accessing this therapy and who is not accessing this therapy, and why is that?
And so we put $150 million to make sure that we close that gap. Mm-hmm. In terms of who's accessing those combination antibody therapies. Absolutely, Dr. Moore.
Yeah, absolutely. And we can see it. We can see it in the data that there is this, you know, that there is this gap. And we have to continue to always be a voice, to always ask questions, to always push forward and to speak up on it. So we are here today, you know, obviously we are women, we are Black women. So we have a lot of women questions. We want to know, how is this affecting women's bodies and pregnancies and babies and breastfeeding and our daughters and our sisters? And so all of that science that people don't understand with the vaccine, and how does it affect reproduction and fertility? What should we know? What do we know? What can you tell us?
Yes, thanks for raising that. I'm in conversation a lot. You know, I can pull up my phone here. One of my cousins texted me just yesterday asking about the fertility questions with the vaccine. So
your cousin goes straight to the source. I've got a really good person to ask.
But I think it's the takeaway, you know, and I think this is so important because, you know, when my cousin writes, like, she doesn't really care about any of these roles, right? She's like, you're a doctor, right? So what can you tell me as a doctor? And that's the truth for so many people, is going to the clinician, the nurses, the doctors, the physician assistants, like the folks you know who are in healthcare can help you understand and navigate the science, right? Who are in your life, go to them. So it's a great question. It's absolutely a great question. And I will start with the question around sort of pregnancy and breastfeeding. So important to know, you know, pregnant folks aren't included in the clinical trials, right? So as we go through the process, and this is very intentional, that's how they all work. They aren't included in the trials. But what we know now, the CDC tells us over 100,000 pregnant women have received the vaccines. And I'm sure this is after a conversation with their providers. And that's always the right answer to have that conversation. But what we can see now looking at those data is that there have not been any safety signals whatsoever in terms of the pregnancy outcomes. And that's really important because what we have seen conversely is that pregnant women are at particularly high risk for severe complication if they contract the SARS-CoV-2 and get COVID-19. So just a really high risk group for getting the virus and having bad outcomes. So you'd want to get the vaccine. So it's really quite encouraging, no safety signals at all, and helpful then to protect against those bad outcomes from COVID-19. So that's really great. Lots of people are continuing to look at that. Even in the last day, there's been more data looking at this and suggesting safety around pregnancy and using it in pregnancy. Some indications in the second trimester might be kind of ideal. These are all discussions to have, of course, with your provider. But the stance of the CDC is that the vaccine should be made available to pregnant women. So really, really important question there. You know, around the question of infertility, similarly, there haven't been any indication or sign. There's not a real mechanistic reason that we would think it would interfere at all with fertility. So early reassurances there, lots of people kind of getting pregnant kind of after vaccination now that we're seeing and without any untoward consequence. So all these early signs, it's really great. We can look to other vaccines too that are similar, right? When we think about the fact that it's not live, let me just say that too, because a lot of people are like, can you get COVID from getting the vaccination? So no live virus at all involved in any of these vaccines and in that way. So if you think about something like flu or tetanus, those are other vaccines that are like this and very, very safe for pregnancy. Lots and lots and lots of data there. So we can look to that evidence base as well. Such an important question. We always have to say, look, as women, we know that we're not always, haven't always been included in scientific research and study. So like, what have we studied now? What do we know? And that's where we are. So really encouraging news on that pregnancy front.
What would you say to new moms who are breastfeeding, nursing? Are the antibodies transferred passively in the breast milk? And if so, is that good for the baby? The baby has some protection, or what do we recommend for sort of breastfeeding if a mother has received the immunization, or should she receive an immunization while she's breastfeeding?
Yeah, our encouragement is still for folks to get vaccinated. Absolutely. And similarly, there, again, the urgency. So let me speak to that, because some folks are sort of like, oh, sure, I'll get vaccinated. You know, give me a few more months. I'm still waiting. And there's some people who say, I don't want to be first. And I remind them that we have surpassed our 200 million vaccination in this country. So nobody is first anymore, right? But why that urgency? So why do we say now? Why do we say, like, don't wait till you're, you know, finished breastfeeding? Why don't you wait until, you know, post-pregnancy? So number one, of course, acutely, is we're trying to prevent in you, right, any of those negative consequences, sequela of COVID-19. We're trying to protect our community as well. And we're just in a race, like we have a race against time, right? In terms of the variants and mutations. And so we have to. So similarly, no evidence that that breastfeeding contraindicated whatsoever. And there's so many benefits from breastfeeding, of course. So we really encourage women to breastfeed and in this context as well. Mm-hmm. So these are, but you know, my first point is, we have to make sure that you are hearing this information, not just from me, somebody you're meeting right now, right? But that you're also talking to the folks that you know, your doctor, your clinician, right? Make sure that you feel comfortable. But the evidence that we have right now suggests safe in pregnancy, safe in breastfeeding, and does not interfere with fertility.
Right. And it's important to know that the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology, Society of Maternal Fetal Medicine, Society of Reproductive Medicine have all come out in support of pregnant women and women desiring to be pregnant to move forward with these vaccines. So yes, such an important conversation. When we look at the compendium of science, the data that was submitted to the FDA in these briefing documents, specifically with African-Americans, with the Black population, and we saw Moderna, 30,000 people enrolled, 10.3% of those people were Black. And Pfizer, 40,000 people enrolled, 9.8% were Black. And Johnson & Johnson had almost 42,000 with 13% African-American and 19% if you include Africans. So, you know, I found that fairly remarkable, because in general, we don't necessarily participate in clinical trials, which is, you know, part of my passion. So what would you say, Dr. Nunez-Smith, when we want to speak directly to African Americans, directly to Black people, and address their vaccine hesitancy, what do we know about these vaccines? Where should we have confidence, and why should we have confidence?
She liked the Barry Minute Maid punch.
Yes. That's exactly right. When we talk about these conversations around vaccine confidence, I think it's always so important to say, like, who has been involved. And this participation in clinical research is key. It's another message. Yeah. I'm so glad you're bringing it, Dr. Morgan. We got to show up, right? We should not take ourselves out of the opportunity to benefit from scientific discovery. I always say, like, we should not check ourselves out of that. And so whether we're talking about vaccines, then that's an important story. These therapies too, right? There are other things too to be part of for clinical research. So important. I think it's a key day when those vaccine manufacturers paused, right? Stopped. And said, we have to make sure that there's representation. And of course, that's because of voices from lots of people, but it's important that that happened, right? That it stopped and paused and said, we're gonna make sure there's adequate representation so that we can look at subgroups, so that people can see themselves in the clinical trials. So what's different, you know, now than before? Because sometimes we have conversations, we know historical reality, we know that. We know contemporary reality, right? We all have stories, I'm sure, of trying to get healthcare and not getting not getting treated respectfully, right? Feeling like we're getting subpar care. So we don't always have to look back either for that. So I have to acknowledge that up front. But there are things that are different. And so when we look at who is at the table in the vaccine development, you know, who is at the table in the review, who's at the table of the policy, who is in the trials, right? Like it's just key, just critical. And we have that diversity now. So we can look and we can say no differences noted at all in terms of subgroups. We see that it was efficacious, right? So in the trials, they seem like it worked. It worked for what we cared about, right? No hospitalizations, no severe illness, no loss of life. Key. Now we see in the real world, which we call effectiveness, we see that real world effectiveness that's bearing out. Mm-hmm. We see particularly for some of the hardest hit groups, people over 65 years of age, for example, the risk of hospitalization and severe COVID has gone down 94%, right, after vaccine. I mean, this is amazing. So the vaccines work. That's number one. The vaccines work. They do. And then number two, millions and millions of people have gotten them and gotten them safely. Right, which is an important conversation, because when we say, you know, be prepared if you get the second dose, you might have a day where you have some flu-like symptoms, you might have soreness at the arm, you might get some fever, right? That's anticipated. So we have to make sure that we communicate to folks what is in that realm of normal, what to expect, right? Those are adverse events, nothing like that, right? So we know that millions safely administered. And we know that this is the pathway. I always talk about reclaiming joy. Because that's what I want to do too, right? We want to gather for worship. We want to gather together with our families for reunions. People want to travel, move around, see loved ones. Like that's how we get there, is by vaccinating. And don't think that somebody else is going to do it, right? It's for us all to do. Absolutely. And so I've been vaccinated, encouraging my family to get vaccinated, and always just meeting people where they are. Always saying, like, you still have questions? Let's keep talking. Because I want to make sure we're building that confidence and people kind of get there. But important to have this information about who was in the trial, who was running the trials, all of that, and knowing that Black folks were very well represented across all of those different components.
Mm-hmm. This is so well said. I actually, early on in the pandemic, penned a scientific analysis of Moderna.
Yes.
Drug development process. And I was, you know, I was somewhat critical of it, but to their credit, you're right. They did pause. And these other companies also were able to take note, and other voices began to speak up from the scientific community about the importance of participating in these vaccine trials. And so we should have confidence that these companies move forward with intention and purpose, and that we were included in these trials. I have a final question for you. Here's a big one. When is this all going to end?
Oh, yes, Dr. Morgan.
Look at your crystal ball.
And the $64,000 question, the crystal ball question. You know, there's light, right? There's light, and I hold hope, I do, and optimism. You know, I think as we, I will say for me, I think it's a blessing for us to be at this moment where we have these vaccines, right? We have a toolkit. It's our most powerful tool in the toolkit is the vaccine and vaccination, but it gives us cause for hope and light, right? And so there is urgency, right? In terms of that speed, because we know we're trying to beat, I said before, we're trying to beat these variants, right? And so we have to say, we're gonna double down, get vaccinated. But, you know, it's going to be a new normal. I would say that too, right? And so we just start thinking about what that new normal is going to look like and feel like, but we can get so much closer to the normal that we had prior to the pandemic. And I get asked all the time, you know, is COVID, SARS-CoV-2 going to be around or not? Is it going to be endemic, right? Is this something like flu that we have to kind of be thinking about getting vaccinated again on a regular basis? And those are the right questions to be asking, right? And perhaps we may need boosters even, right? So some of that, but there is a path that you can see now to us beginning to open up again. So I don't know, you know, I know not the day nor the hour, but I know that there is cause and reason for celebration, for hope, for optimism. And really, I'm just grateful. Let me just say, just grateful to have this kind of platform and space for us to be honest and in conversation together. Dr. Morgan, to you for your leadership, for all that you have done, right? Like, your name in history, because you are, right, a leading voice for us and pushing on, and that's what we need. So thank you, Dr. Morgan, and to everyone here. I can't wait to be together in person, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes,
on the other side of this pandemic.
Thank you so much for coming today. This was such a great conversation. We were so honored to have you. And I am hoping that not only all of the participants here, but everybody who will see it later across the nation, across the world, will gather some courage and some confidence at your transparency and your authenticity, and certainly your experience and your pedigree to say, I can step up and take this vaccine. This vaccine is for me. I'm going to be a part of the solution of reaching herd immunity, because I heard Dr. Nunez Smith, it came straight from her mouth, and she was the only person that I wanted to hear from. And in hearing from her, that gave me the courage to move forward to do what we need to do as a nation. So I appreciate it. Thank you so very much for coming and joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Be well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much.